Now, I'm royalty. You're royalty as you belong to Christ in the sense that you are possessing His life within you, that His blood runs through you in that spiritual sense. So what is the display of your wealth? With royalty comes all this opportunity, comes all this chance to be under the authority of the King of Kings and to be used in carrying out His business. And what would be the leftover after your life is over if they put the treasures of you on display? There's a story I heard years ago about a man who went to heaven, and St. Peter was showing him around. He was showing him all these elaborate things that you find, I guess, in heaven. And he was noticeably not showing him a certain building. It was a big building that went way up. And this guy was not seeing anything else because he'd noticed he'd missed this. And so he said, "What is in that building? I want to see that building." And St. Peter said, "Well, really, I didn't want you to see that. I'd rather we just go on and show you some other things." He says, "No, I want to see that building. You're not showing me that building for a reason." So St. Peter took him over to the building, opened it up, and here was a room just filled with shelves. And as he looked up, he could see that the shelves went as far as you could see, and they just disappeared in the distance that the eye could not see any farther. And he began to examine the things on the shelves and said, "I could have used that. When I was 15, I could have used that. When I was 20, I could have used that. When I was 30, I could have used that. Why weren't these things given to me? They looked like they were just there for me." St. Peter just simply said, "You never asked. You never asked." All the blessings that could have been sent into our lives. When I get to heaven, I want to see two rooms. I want to see an empty room and a full room. I want to see an empty room of all the things that God preordained for me in this life that I took time to pray for and got the blessing out of while I was here. And I want to see a full room filled with all the treasures that I've sent ahead by obedience to God, serving God, and how you get treasures in heaven. That's my job description on this earth, is to try to get one room empty and one room full. And the royalty that we have, we are a royal priesthood. And in the Bible, that was never mixed before. David was the king. Nathan was the priest or the prophet. You had Samuel, who was the priestly prophet. And then you had Saul, who tried to imitate him and got in deep trouble because of that. He was the king who tried to do the priestly duty of sacrifice. In Christ, they're mixed together. We are priests and kings. We are the priesthood of believers, and also we're adopted into the lineage of kings. He didn't mix the tribe of Levi and the tribe of Judah. But in us, you mix a king and a priest. And as priests, we have that responsibility to reach out and to win souls for Christ, to intercede for people, to represent God to people and people to God. There was a lady whose name was Aunt Sophie, and Aunt Sophie could not see. She couldn't get glasses that were thick enough for her to see well. And Aunt Sophie was caught one day witnessing, and the reason she recognized something was up was everybody began laughing at her. When she figured it out, she figured out she was witnessing to a cigar store Indian standing in front of the store. And people began to make fun of Sophie for doing that. And she made a statement, I think woke them back up and said, "Well, I'd rather be caught witnessing to a wooden Indian and to be a wooden Christian who never speaks to anybody at all." And we have that responsibility to be that, not only kings, a royal priesthood, but to be reaching out to this lost world with the authority that being of that royal lineage gives us. A third thing that we find that is true about the value we have in Christ is that I am a part of a holy nation. I am a part of a holy nation. That word holy literally means we are set apart. We are a nation that is distinct. Our boundary lines are not geographical, but our boundary lines are distinct by our morals and by Christ who possesses them. We are a holy nation in Christ, set apart by the Holy Spirit, distinct in our relationship with Christ. There was a jewelry salesman, and somebody was noticing his hands, how clean they were, and he said this to him. He said, "Of all persons, I should have clean hands. I cannot offer diamonds and pearls or jewels to any customers with hands that are not clean. How can we offer the person of Christ to people with our lives being dirty? We are to be a holy nation. There should be a distinction that is so glaring between us and the world around us. It should be made obvious. There was an African prince who was asked about his own commitment that he was making because he couldn't read. And his answer was, I can't read this book that they talk of. But for 2 years I've watched these missionaries' lives, and I can see the book in them. And that is why I believe. The power of being set apart, to being holy, to being like God, and being together. The Church of Christ is called a nation. It seems like it's a bunch of island chains nowadays, all separate from one another. All the bickering that goes on. But God calls us a nation. That means we are aligned together. We are a body. We are a temple. We are a nation together. Whenever the Olympics happen and I see the guy from, or the girl from the United States of America competing in whatever way they're competing, I'm just rooting and rooting and rooting. I don't root for the Russian and I don't root for the French guy. I root for the American. Whenever that American wins, that American gets up on that those three podiums there and stands up there and they play the Star Spangled Banner, you know, I just get all goosebumps because we're connected. I'm an American. They're an American. And we are a nation together. When you think of different nations around the world, you think of the British and you think of prim and proper. It brings an idea to your head. Think of the Italian, you think of the Swedish. What do you think of when you think of American around the world today? The people who know you, what do they think of when they think of Christian? We are to be a holy nation. And as a nation, we support each other, we encourage each other, we go the same way together, we cooperate with each other, and we accomplish what is necessary in the life of the kingdom of God. Let me give you a fourth one real quickly. I am a part of God's own possession. I belong to God. The Bible says you have been bought with a price. You are no longer your own. You get out there and make a statement like, I'm my own man. That's not true if you're a Christian. You don't belong to yourself anymore. You've been bought with a price. Christ paid that purchase price. He is the master who possesses us. He is the King of kings. We are a nation of kingly slaves because we have a master. We have royal blood in our veins, but we are slaves of one master, who is Christ. Your Bible may say that we are peculiar people. And some people turn on Christian TV stations and they see the kind of hair that happens there and the kind of makeup and dress and everything and activities, and they say, yeah, they're peculiar, all right. That's not the peculiar. The peculiar that the Bible talks about is when the disciples are sitting there in that upper room and Jesus puts on a towel and begins to wash their feet, and they think, this is peculiar. Jesus makes a statement like, we're not like the Gentiles who lord it over one another, but whoever wants to be the greatest among you shall be your slave. Now that's peculiar. But the peculiar things, the more in-depth your relationship and walk with God, the more strength you find in your godliness, the more those things aren't peculiar anymore. Maybe to the world, but to you, they make total sense. Because you're becoming more like Christ in your thinking. We are God's own possession, and as His possession, we're a little bit odd. A little bit different from the world. And that's exactly the way we should be. But as the world comes to Christ and begins to understand, they begin to see that this is the way God works, that faith does make sense, that God does work in the lives of people who trust Him, who seem to put their lives at risk because He's called them to a certain test in life. And yet God just fills all the necessary undergirding and provides for them. Peculiar. But it takes you places that the things of this world will never take. We are God's own possession. As God's possession, we find two things that are very interesting about our life. His calling. He has called us to proclaim his excellencies. We are called to proclaim the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Now, God has the money. If God wanted to do it in Madison Avenue way, God could buy time at this year's Super Bowl. He could spend $1 million for 30 seconds this year, and he could put his own banner. He's got those guys hanging around the end zones with John 3:16, so he could just take a commercial time if he wanted to. But he's chosen to do it a little different. He's not chosen to use Madison Avenue. He's chosen to use Main Street Christians. He's chosen to use our lives. And if believers choose not to speak up, then the witness of Christ is going to be silent. We have the responsibility to proclaim the excellencies of him. And something else you can proclaim, not just by your words, but by your lifestyle. See, he's the excellencies of him who's called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. What that says is that your life should be experiencing marvelous light. If you're a believer who's still living in the darkness, still not growing in truth, being enlightened, living in the darkness of sin, and really you don't have a stage to proclaim his excellencies to this world. But if you've experienced what it means to move from an old life to a new life, from darkness of evil to the experience of the abundance of grace, then you have a lot to say to this world. That word proclaim means to advertise, means to tell forth the excellencies of God's way. Glenn Campbell, he said this. He said, "I never knew how truly happy a person could be by living their life serving Jesus Christ." And this is the Rhinestone Cowboy and Wichita lineman, the guy who had all these number one hits. And he gets past all that point of his life, all the drugs that followed, the problems that followed, the alcohol that followed, and he gets past that and he finds Jesus Christ and he says, "I never knew a person could be so happy in serving Jesus Christ. Not in God dumping all this good stuff on me, but just serving God. I never knew a person could be that happy." Our lives should be a neon light advertising that taste and see that the Lord is good. Proclaiming the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness into a marvelous light. And let that light just shine. Let your light shine in such a way that men see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. So we have his calling. We also are his body. You were once not a people, but now you are the people of God. I'm looking out there at the body of Christ. I see some ears out there. I see some hands out there. I see some feet out there. We're all different. We were all separate from one another at a point in time. But as we all came into the kingdom of God, we were once not a people, but now we are the people of God. Now we have a connection that for many of us is much stronger than even our own family connections. There is something so much deeper in knowing Christ. Something so much more eternal that it's recognizable. You can't hide it away. And we were once not a people, but now we are the people of God. Now if you need a little motivation, I think Peter throws it in at the end. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. If I just stop long enough and start an impossible activity, and that's try to add up all my sins. And as I go through sin after sin, if God gave me perfect recall, and I went day after day after day and just listed these sins, I don't think there's enough paper that the trees can make to list out all my sins. And then as I was just burdened down with all that and then recognizing, all this is under the blood of Christ. I've received a mercy. That puts energy in to telling others. That encourages me so strongly to let other people know, I don't care what you've done. What you've done in life is never going to outweigh what Christ did for you on the cross. What a wonderful motivation to live out the truths that Peter just presented to him. When I was brand new in Christ, I decided I was going to do anything and everything that God called me to do. So I had an opportunity to be a counselor at a Jay Strack crusade in Tulsa, Oklahoma. They gave me about an hour's worth of direction on what to present. I took notes down, and you know, they'll say this and say that and lead to this scripture and to that scripture. And I got all my notes ready. And then that night after the crusade, after they were having the invitation out there, I found my seat in there in the room where they were going to bring everybody. And then in came this stream of people. I can still see it in my mind today, this stream of all different ages and sizes came in that had responded to the altar call. And I noticed this young man that was about my age at that time, maybe a year or so younger, had his full beard, came walking in and plopped right down in front of me. And he had this look in his eye that was a look that was almost a confusion. It kind of looked like, well, I don't know how much expectation I can have here. Like, I've done this before. I don't know if it's going to work. And he sat down there, and I started going through all my notes that I had. Well, this is point A, point B, and this is this scripture, and the Bible says all of sin, ways of sin. And he kept saying, I know that. Yeah, I know that. Yeah, I know that. Yeah, I dated a missionary's daughter. I know the family well. I've heard all these things before. And I was going nowhere, and I got to the bottom of my page, and I didn't have anything else to go to. And so I began to say, God, okay, I don't have anything else for this guy. And everything they gave me is not working. And God brought my mind back to the most valuable thing I had. And I began to share with him what God had done for me, how God had changed my life, where I was and where God has brought me now, the chaos of my past and the purpose of my present, the hope I have for the future, how different God made it in a moment in time. And as I started sharing these things, it brought a brand new energy into me because it was all so powerful and true to me. And his eyes began to lift up, and he kept saying, is that true? Are you telling the truth? Did that really happen? And finally he said, that is what I want. That is what I'm looking for. And with that, he finally had captured what brought him to a freedom praying that prayer of inviting Christ into his life. Because he knew all the mechanics. I'd gone through them again. He wasn't impressed by the way I did it either. But what he was looking for was the power to change lives that God promised him. That next Sunday, he met me in the vestibule and grabbed me and said, you wouldn't believe what's been happening. Last night we were out at a concert downtown, and we were witnessing the people as they came out, and God was just blessing us, and I'm just so excited for what God's done this past week in my life. Just a transformation from those hollow eyes to this light inside this person. Now, I could not argue him with facts and figures into the kingdom of God. But God had put something of value into me. When I recognize it, in its fullest sense, there's power there. I'm a chosen race. I'm a royal priesthood. I'm part of a holy nation. I'm possessed by God. God's given me this wonderful calling to proclaim Him and His excellencies, how He's changed me from darkness to light, how He's given me this wonderful mercy. And I was not part of a people. He's made me part of His body, the people of God. What a wonderful message to take to a lost, dark world. And every one of us has that message. And we have to decide, when God says, I've chosen you, are we going to be willing to say, God, whatever you ask in my life, here I am, send me. Would you bow with me?